The year 2020 was certainly an eventful one. A global pandemic, lockdowns, life grinding to a halt. As we faced our new socially distanced reality during that fateful year, many of us looked for ways to keep ourselves distracted while we stayed at home. As items on the store shelves got scarce, people got creative. For some of us, this meant learning to bake sourdough bread. And for others, this meant Dalgona coffee. This whipped combination of sugar, water, and instant coffee got its name from Korean actor Jung Il-woo. He tried some on a television program where he said it reminded him of the Dalgona candy he enjoyed as a child. In the following months, Koreans started making this coffee drink themselves and shared videos of it on TikTok. This trend quickly spread around the world, with its name getting anglicized to Dalgona. Venerable coffee professionals even got in on the act. Dalgona coffee works for several reasons. It's made from ingredients that are easily accessible even during pandemic shortages. It's easy to make, albeit tiring on the wrists when made by hand. Most importantly, it's photogenic and well-suited for sharing on social media. The final product is a clever inversion of the cappuccino, with coffee serving as the foamy top instead of milk. Foam is an often overlooked part of many of the drinks that we enjoy, and the Dalgona coffee trend is a good reminder of this. But what exactly is foam? Why does it form in some beverages but not in others? Does it foam serve any purpose in these drinks? In this BevGeek video, we're going to take a closer look at the science behind foam. Foam is defined as a light frothy mass of fine bubbles formed in or on the surface of a liquid. So to form a foam, a beverage needs to have a gas source to create bubbles. This can either be a gas dissolved in solution or an undissolved gas that is added to the liquid. But gas is not enough. For the bubbles to form into a foam, the liquid needs to provide a support structure to keep the bubbles from bursting on the surface. Foamy beverages have the support structure in the form of surface active agents, or surfactants for short. Surfactants are organic compounds that have two ends, a hydrophilic end that is attracted to water, and a hydrophobic end that is repelled by water. The hydrophobic end can attach to a number of things, but for the sake of our discussion, they attach to the gas in our liquid. These surfactants then bond with each other to trap the gas inside the liquid, forming a bubble. When these bubbles rise to the surface of the liquid, the surfactants maintain their bonds with each other and the gas, allowing a stable foam to form. Some beverages lack a sufficient amount of surfactants to create a stable foam, even if they have a gas source. Champagne, for example, has dissolved carbon dioxide, which is created through a secondary in-bottle fermentation. This carbon dioxide is released once the bottle is open, making the wine effervescent, but champagne lacks the surfactants for the bubbles to maintain their structure once they reach the top of the glass. The same is true with carbonated soft drinks. Carbon dioxide is dissolved into these beverages at high pressure, forming bubbles in the drink when the pressure is released by opening the can or bottle. As with champagne, most soft drinks lack the surfactants to create a stable foam. A few beverages that are well known for their foam are... The head on a glass of beer is one of the most ubiquitous foams around. Beers typically have carbon dioxide dissolved in them through a pressurized carbonation process after brewing is completed. While carbon dioxide is formed during fermentation, this usually escapes while brewing. While some bottle-conditioned beers are carbonated using in-bottle fermentation, like with champagne, most are carbonated using a similar process to that of soft drinks. Proteins released from the grains used to make the beer act as the surfactants. Barley contains lipid transfer proteins that are highly hydrophobic, which cause them to cling to the carbon dioxide as it escapes from the beer. These proteins then cross-link with each other, as well as with isoalpha acids from the hops, to form a stable foam at the top of the glass that lasts for several minutes. Wheat also contains lipid transfer proteins, but has a higher percentage of them than barley, which gives wheat beers a more stable foam which lasts for several minutes longer. The head on a glass of beer helps give it a smooth, creamy texture, which can soften a beer's flavor. It also traps aromas at the top of the glass, allowing for slower flavor release. Beer head is an indicator that a good amount of carbon dioxide has been released during the pour, which can reduce bloating while drinking. Plus, it gives beer its signature appearance. I mean, when you have a glass of beer with a nice foamy top on it, it just looks like beer. Sure, the headless Iceman pour has been a trend on Instagram over the past few years, but this just doesn't look right. This looks like a glass of juice, not a glass of beer. And then there are the nitro beers. These use nitrogen, an insoluble gas that releases smaller bubbles than carbon dioxide. This type of beer, first made popular by the Irish brewer Guinness, has a denser head that lasts longer and a creamier texture than carbonated beers. Plus, the cascade of these tiny bubbles towards the top of the glass makes for a cool visual effect, especially in darker beers. Espresso drinks have become a popular fixture in the coffee scene over the past few decades, and steamed milk is a major part of that. Milk by itself doesn't have any dissolved or trapped gases, so air has to be whipped into it to form a foam. This is done by drawing air into the milk with the steam wand during the initial stage of steaming the milk. Milk, like beer, has a fair amount of proteins, specifically casein and whey. Heating the milk by steaming it allows for some of these proteins to go through a process called denaturation. When a protein denatures, its structure starts to unfold, exposing internal segments that allow them to form new bonds. A good example of this is the albumin in egg whites. As an egg is heated, the proteins in the egg whites reform into a web which traps water molecules, turning it from a clear liquid into a white solid. Caseins are very heat stable and mostly keep their structure when being steamed, whereas the whey proteins are far more heat sensitive. As the whey proteins unwind, hydrophobic points in their structure are exposed, allowing them to trap the drawn-in air as bubbles. The whey proteins in milk make it a great candidate for foaming, whereas the lack of it in plant-based milks presents a challenge. Companies that make milk alternatives specifically formulate their barista-ready versions using additional surfactants to help facilitate foaming. Milk foam is largely a secondary effect of the steaming process, which heats milk without scalding it to give it a sweeter flavor. However, the foam in milk-based coffee drinks has become their staple. Like with the head-on beer, it's hard to imagine a cappuccino without its white, cloud-like top. Milk foam also thickens the texture of the drink and gives baristas an opportunity to show off some creativity, topping their espresso drinks with beautiful latte art. Speaking of espresso, Crema is the reddish-brown layer of foam on top of a shot of espresso. Like with beer head, Crema is the result of carbon dioxide, which in this case is a byproduct of roasting the coffee beans. This carbon dioxide is trapped in the beans until the espresso is ground and brewed under high pressure. It then dissolves into the liquid before escaping and forming a foam at the top of the cup. The amount of carbon dioxide in the beans has a direct impact on the amount of crema, with darker roasts creating more crema than lighter roasts, and espressos made with some Robusta in the coffee blend creating more crema than those made entirely from Arabica coffee. The surfactants in espresso are, well, it's complicated. Coffee is a complex mix of different chemical compounds, and we're still learning more about how they all interact with each other. Polysaccharides, proteins, and melanoidins in the coffee are all believed to provide structure for the crema. Both the surfactants and the carbon dioxide needed to form crema are also present in drip coffee, and bubbles will initially form at the top of the coffee grounds when brewing begins. This can easily be seen when making coffee with a manual pour-over brewer. However, without additional brewing pressure, the carbon dioxide never fully dissolves into drip coffee, and the concentration of surfactants is far too low for a stable foam to form, unlike in the more concentrated espresso. Crema in espresso can serve as an indicator of a coffee's freshness. In order to have enough carbon dioxide to form crema, the coffee will need to have been roasted within the past few months and ground within the past few minutes. Given that coffee with a lack of carbon dioxide has likely lost much of its aroma, crema can be a sign that the espresso still has most of its flavor. A light crema can also be a sign that an espresso may be under-extracted. Plus, like with beer and steamed milk, crema adds to the overall visual appeal of the espresso. And now, we circle back to Dalgona coffee. Making it is pretty straightforward. Combine equal parts by volume of instant coffee, sugar, and hot water. Whisk or blend them together until they form a smooth, mousse-like foam. Whisking by hand, this took me about 5 minutes. This foam can be used in a variety of applications, but for that Instagram-ready drink, use it to top a glass of cold milk on ice. Air whipped into the foam acts as the gas source. The surfactants are the same ones found in espresso, this time at a higher concentration. The sugar in Dalgona coffee also helps to support foam stability. The sugar increases the viscosity and the total dissolved solids of the solution, leading to a meringue-like foam that can stay stable for days. Even after a full week, very little liquid settles out of the Dalgona foam, and it maintains most of its structure. How does it taste? Well, I've never had Dalgona, but Dalgona coffee does have a similar taste to honeycomb candies that I've had before. It's very sweet, with a burnt sugar taste, and has a rich texture to it. If you have it with a fair amount of milk, it's fine. But to be fair, this is more of a small do-it-yourself project than a drink. If you're making Dalgona coffee, you're probably thinking more about posting it on social media than you are enjoying a glass of it with a pastry and a good book. While the Dalgona coffee fad has passed, it's a good reminder of how important foam is in many of our favorite beverages. Putting a lens to its formation gives us a glimpse into the complex chemistry and physics of these drinks, and can give us a good appreciation for what it takes to make them. social media will inevitably move on to the next trend. While we're all now singing sea shanties on TikTok, we'll continue to enjoy these classic foamy beverages for years to come. I hope you enjoy the video. If so, click the like button. It really does help out the channel. Also, make sure to subscribe and click the bell icon so you'll be notified when new videos are released. What are your thoughts on Dalgona coffee? Did you think it was a fun little trend? Were you glad to see it go away? What is your favorite beverage? Let me know in the comments. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you for the next BevGeek video.